my super defense. My name is Chun-Hao Chen, and my research is mental disorder depression due to bipolar disorder and borderline personality disorder. I'll be speaking English because we have suffering over thinking. In short, I'll just go with BPD, bipolar and BPD, both two of the disorders. And basically, in this research, we propose a complete framework that you can collect data from patients, and we also use data to build an online detection model. So first of all, I'm just asking. 80% of people in the United States are suffering from mental disorder based on some form. So it's kind of a serious issue. And a lot of researchers trying to use the data science point of view to use the data on social network to analyze and to predict mental disorders. So the motivation is quite simple. First, imagine that if we can access to all the data of patients on social network, it will be very powerful in the research. And compared to traditional approach, we can get much, much more data. And if we have an online prediction system, well, it's not going to replace the professional diagnosis of the doctors, but it will be very convenient if we can automatically knew the tendency of a social network user being mentally unhealthy. Okay. So the breakdown, actually, originally, we just want to use some sentiment analysis technique to capture people with unstable emotion patterns. And then we realized that actually bipolar disorder and borderline personality disorder, they are kind of, they have unstable impulsive emotions. So that's why we step into the area that combines clinical psychology with data science. It's still a relatively new area. So I have these two very important variables in the So firstly is for Microsoft, predicting depression from social media. So they use Amazon Turks, which is a crowdsourcing website. So they spend money to recruit some depression patients and ask them to fill some questionnaires and ask their field data. And they build some linguistic model with very high precision. But now we can no longer do it, because now Amazon Turks forbidden workers to give their personal data. So we can no longer use their method to collect all the data. Okay. Second level is quantifying mental health sickness in Twitter. It's from John Hopkins. So they use an automatic approach. It's very simple. Just see this, I was diagnosed with X. It's a very simple string. If any Twitter mentioned this string, I was diagnosed with BPD, bipolar eating disorder, then they somehow confirm these people is suffering from that disorder. So it's very automatic. And the way they build in the prediction model is very similar to Microsoft. But we apply the same approach on 700 million tweets along with 11 months. We only find 8 bipolar and 3 BPD patients, which is very, very inefficient. And the worst thing is that Twitter data is free to access, but it's illegal to share on public. So imagine if you want to reproduce the research, you need to collect the data maybe 3 or 4 years, and then to sample enough patients for research. Okay. So the first challenge in this area is that how do we efficiently collect data on patients? Since the previous study, the first method is illegal, the second approach is inefficient. And secondly, is the predictive model detecting people having disorder or just talking about it? So, imagine you have the data from a patient, right? And they confirm their diagnosis on public. So it's not surprising that they are always sharing their sickness, talking about experiences, right? So in the end, is the model really predicting people having it or just people talking about it? It's two different things, right? Okay. And in previous research, they just see if the model performs with very high decision making in the model school. They didn't evaluate in this from this perspective. So this is framework. We first we collect data, we do some simple processing, and we extract the features from the text and apply some machine learning technique to build a prediction model. So to collect data, the key is community, because there are a lot of support group communities on Twitter that patients just go there and share their experiences and support each other and to know more people similar to them. So the key is the community. If we can find a community, we can target the patients and collect the data. So firstly, we need to find where are the communities. So first we define community portals. is to the account that followed by a lot of potential patients. Okay, so to help the search is very simple. So firstly, we search for BPD if you want to find BPD patients. You just search for BPD. And you have to manually judge if this account, if you are a patient, would you like to follow this kind of account? So this is healing from BPD. So I judge that, well, if I am a patient, I would like to follow this account and to know more people like me. So we first thing we have to manually collect this kind of portal. Okay. And once we collect the portals, we can extract patients from the community. So the way once we we extract patients, and the way we extract patients is to do some keyword matching from the profile. So we can see this is a BPD patient. And the profile, this person confirmed he is diagnosed with BPD and NDD and some other diagnosis. So that's how we confirm this person is infection. So we also need to extract experts. So why I'm an expert? It's quite confusing. Because we want to see if the model are really predicting people who have a disorder, right? So experts are the people who they could be a subgroup, they could be doctors who working on this disorder specifically. So this is a group that helping people with BPD. And we use them because they are always talking about mental disorders, but they don't have it. Well, I assume they don't have it. So it will be very useful to evaluate a model. Okay. So we also need some mentally healthy people, random people. That's why. Because we need to use some machine learning technique to learn what people are healthy and what people are not healthy, so we can build a prediction model there. So we just randomly sample computer users. And we assume these random users, they don't have bipolar BPD, because the prevalence of bipolar is 2.6%, BPD is 1.6%. So even if we have some mentally unhealthy people in that group, it wouldn't damage the prediction model, the performance of the prediction model in the end. So prepositing is very simple. We just will apply two criteria. If we need people with more than 100 tweets, and this version cannot have too much hyperlinks in the text, otherwise we think we cannot extract too much information. And then feature extraction. In previous study, usually they use linguistic models, so they just directly using the frequency of their text to build a prediction model. And we think that's not so good. So we want to build a pattern of light features. Actually, this feature is proposed by Shaw Hopkins, but in their research, this model had quite bad precision, so they didn't to try to emphasize it. And we think actually this feature is very good because it tries to reveal the person, the personality behind the text. They don't use the text directly to mark it, right? So these features actually can reveal the emotional patterns, the social interaction habits, and age gender of the person, right? And we further improve it. And the way we improve is that we include the polarity, emotions, and both of them actually refer to the emotion of the single text. And we also use endogenous social interaction, which exists before, to form the panel of white features. So we compose this panel of white features, we need to classify all the tweets into polarity, which can be categorized into positive, negative, and neutral, three different kind of states. And also eight emotion, which is proposed by Robert Fonchik, the emotion group. So two different kinds of emotions. And in order to capture the trace of the youngster emotions, we have to see that if they change the emotion from happy to sad, or from sad to happy in short time, or if they post continuous negative posts in short time to capture the impulsive emotions. Okay. So that's the best. So after we extract the features, we can apply some machine learning technique, use a classifier to train the prediction model. So that's the our message. Okay. So in terms of experiments, there's all the data we're collecting here. We have 548 random samples and 278 bipolar patients and around 250 patients. and some expert. This expert will be used for evaluation. So when we train the prediction model, we wouldn't use expert. They are just for evaluation. And for each group, we have, on average, around 100, 300 weeks for every user. So in order to compare our model, we don't apply model, we use two of the state-of-art models. So firstly is TF-IEF model. So it's basically captured all the words that are used by users. Capture all the words, the frequency of words. And in the previous research, it has the highest precision. So we want to compare the applied with it. And the previous research, they all use LIDAR model, which is psychological dictionary. We also compare them. Okay. So this is, we have three different evaluation criteria. And firstly, is temporal post-validation. So all the previous research use this way. We just want to see how precise the model is. So that's the result. Okay, firstly, in bipolar, you can see that TF-IEF really has the highest precision here. As for pattern of life, you can see that when the recall is 80%, we have around about 80% of precision. It's like, and it's maybe it's as safe as LIDAR, maybe a little bit inferior, but you can see that TF-IEF really has the highest precision. And the situation in BT is quite the same. And secondly, we need to see that is the model really detecting people who are having disorder but not talking about it, right? That's the most important thing. So we use the experts, the people who are talking about disorder but not having it. We use them as a testing data to see the precision. So that's the interesting stuff. You can see the pattern of life has really high precision, and TF-IEF performs really poor. They somehow classify the experts into patients. They think they are the patients. It's quite bad. So it's actually not as good as the previous research stated. Okay. So let's take a closer look why TF-IEF performs so bad. So this is the top 10 features for each disorder, bipolar and BPD. So you can see the keywords in here. So mental health, DBT, I think it's a therapy, and borderline therapy, and some bipolar blocker. So you can see that actually TF-IEF has a tendency to detect people, the topic of people. So they actually kind of, detecting who people who just talking about it. So that's why we think it's quite bad. That's why it performs so bad in social bias test. Okay. And in next step is limited data test, because we want to know, if a tutor user, they only have 100 tweets or 200 tweets, how does it influence the decision, right? Okay. So this is in the bipolar, and you can see in pattern of life, if the user have more than 200 tweets, it can reach around 80% of the decision. So the more data you have, of course, it's better. And as for BPD, it seems like it's easier. If you have 200 tweets, you can reach around 85% of the decision. So the conclusion is that, firstly, we propose a very efficient and accessible way to collect the data for attention. So even if you don't want to do a prediction model, you can use this way to collect data for your psychological research. And secondly, we improve the pattern of life model, and the model that used to be ignored. We think this is a very good model, and this model actually can give you high precision to detect patients, and most importantly, low bias. They don't suffer from association bias. Okay, so let's see my system. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
It was a very fast presentation. So I had a lot of questions to ask.
Yeah, sure.
So my first round was too long, so got all the content.
So I guess we take turns. Okay, I think I can go first. So how can I start? let's see. Uh, So for example, like here you compare three different kinds of models.
Yes.
One is the look and also say TF-IDF and also Pinot and Black. But it's not clear to me how you, so this, so for example, I can understand the TF-IDF parts, but I don't know exactly how you did the feature extraction parts. For example, like for from look, if you input say a text file into look, and it will provide you those states
yes.
of different kind of categories.
Yes.
So yeah, linguistic categories.
Yes.
And so those would become the feature vector into your model. Right?
Yes.
Okay. So and pattern of life means
actually it means that well the pattern the life actually means the person. So the living pattern, the emotional pattern, or the habits of the person. So actually, text is just a tool to reveal it.
Yeah, but how do you calculate
okay.
or extract patterns from those texts?
Okay, so let's get into configuration.
Okay, it's like a like analysis or
yeah.
like PCA or stuff.
PCA. No, we didn't use PCA.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just want to understand. Yeah.
Okay. So. This was the version I spent too much time. Okay, pattern of life. So it actually consists with four criteria. So firstly is polarity, right?
Okay.
So it's the percentage of positive and negative emotion, and also the combos. Combos are if you post continuous post with the same polarity, will positive or negative. And flips is the tendency of the user flipping from positive, the negative, or the other way around in short time. So that's polarity. And emotions is the percentage of the eight emotions in the emotion world.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we also use age and gender, because actually in Twitter, the age and gender is not revealed. So we actually use some previous research in here. They build a lexica, so we use this lexica to infer the age of the gender and the gender of the user to use as particular features. And we also try to capture the social interaction. So it's quite simple. We just see how frequent the user mentioned others in the tweet. And if the person has more concentrated network by evaluating how many were frequently friends being frequently mentioned in the networks. Okay. Yeah. So that's kind of four features we combine all of them to form our pattern of life features.
Okay. So it's like 20 dimensions also.
19. Yeah.
Okay. And how did you do the selection bias test?
Okay. So we actually use the experts. So firstly, we use all the data to train the complete model,
Yeah.
And then we use the experts as the testing model to see the precision.
This is the part I didn't understand because,
okay.
For example, you ask those. So I know you identify those experts, portal or page,
yes.
Twitter accounts. But did you ask them to kind of label other accounts for you?
No, I didn't.
Okay, so you just collect what they say, their tweets,
yeah.
and then use another model.
Yeah.
But those experts are just talking about it, about the mental disorder,
yeah.
right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So they would become a kind of a prediction model for. They would become the data for
testing.
For testing, but like as normal category.
And the model will say, well, you are questions, you are not known because you are talking about this one.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Got you. Okay. I see.
Forgot to mention, we just released our online demo. But now, because I don't have internet in here, that later I will send you the link. So you can play around. So we compare Donald Trump with a random VPD patient. So we can see that.
You can turn on the Wi-Fi.
But no, my computer has some problem, so I cannot access.
Can you use like other people's computer?
Yeah, maybe there. Yeah.
Also, in your presentation, you mentioned the alternation cycles of emotions, and did that the kind of information go into your model? Or,
actually, we use to remember the flips and combos.
Oh, okay. So it's like one of the feature dimensions.
Yeah, it's
can
still
you describe more about the combo because it's not really exact.
So this is called. So each phase actually means the emotion of a tweet. If these all tweets appear in short time, you can say about 2 hours.
Right.
So it's like the person post 3 negative posts within 2 hours. So it's kind of combos. So it becomes a feature to capture the impulsive emotions. On the experiment, we found that DPD has more expense compared to our. It seems like I didn't include the chart, but DPD seems more negative and more emotional unstable.
But he wants to compare with someone who's bipolar or
whatever.
Yes.
Now, right here, we actually just do some testing, not really.
So maybe we can try your Twitter account.
Yeah, I don't have it.
You don't have a Twitter account?
Try my one.
Go.
Well, I have one, but I never use it.
But it's already fetching the data.
So the first question is that how do you deal with the individual differences of the patient? Say some patient they may be very severe and some they're not as severe as others.
Yeah.
Does that affect the way how you build your model, or you don't have a way to actually know how severe they are?
Currently, we like all the patients for the model is just the same. If they
right.
current, yeah. So we actually in the current state we don't consider what's the seriousness. The best thing we can do is just give her well, the probability of having it is the worst kind of from the seriousness.
Yeah, because that's something that you may want to take into account. So you will maybe have a more predictive model.
Yeah.
if you know how severe they are, and then combining with the whatever pattern of life data that you have. So another question is also mentioned by other Professor Wang is, for bipolar disorder patients, they do have like clear cycles of being mania or being depressive.
Yes.
How do you take that into account? Or
yeah,
because if you're only using flips, you're probably getting one flip.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that might affect the way how your model was built.
Yes, currently, if the cycle period is very long, for example, like 1 week depression period and 1 week maniac.
Yeah.
I think the model currently maybe it has difficulty to capture long time cycle. And because sleep still is only capture the short term, so I think we didn't like look really considerate to build to capture longer.
Right.
Cycle.
Yeah, but I assume that it's possible to actually take into account how the duration between a flip, right? And also duration between combos. Yeah, but you are now setting a limit like within
short time
that if there's a flip in motion, you count it as a flip.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't happen during that period, then the system doesn't detect that.
Yeah. And it also has more difficulties because, well, if you want to measure the long term flip, like, well, this period is quite kind of low and next episode is kind of high, the user needs to provide more data and it's like more difficult.
Yeah,
that's kind of,
they
will be kind of challenging, but nice way to
improve. Right. Yeah, so I'm not very familiar with Spreaker because I think it's very complicated to use. So is that whatever you posted on Twitter, is it open to public or you can set the privacy settings? Right, so, but what you're extracting is the public open data, right? So you wouldn't know what happens in the private world.
No.
Or, no, and there's no way of knowing by what percentage their tweets are open to public and what percentage are private.
Because if we get the data, it will be illegal because it's
the
private data.
Tweets actually, most of the data in tweets are public.
Right,
yeah. So by default, I think it's open to the public,
right.
And then people just because the people are lazy, so
because
it's open to people.
Right. So for that part, but actually, some people actually mentioned that, for example, Facebook probably will having a better issue to control privacy, so maybe it will be more personal as compared to tweets, because tweets is probably just like announcement.
It depends on you, set the side. I can't remember the last time I used Twitter, so it's not easy for me to comment.
Yes, it actually really happened. Like some data they just well, currently I cannot suddenly I just cannot get the data because they shut down.
Right.
Make it fire.
So is it up and running or
the Trumps.
Yeah.
Real Donald Trump.
Real
Donald
Trump.
Real
Donald Trump. Is it like a fake
Donald Trump?
But okay, so you don't need to specify whether they are patient.
And we don't need their permission, we can just collect the data because it's in public.
So how do you deal with retweets?
Oh, currently we don't consider the content retweet at all.
Right, so what if they are retweeting someone else's tweets? You don't count that?
It's possible.
Okay.
Because the idea of panel applies to like to see the person how it has. So the retweet is actually not from them.
Not from them.
But it's still what? But it still would be a good idea to advance the LP.
So have you tried different ways to categorize emotions? Because I know you found someone else doing that, separating emotion into 8 categories, but in reality, they may be, some say it's 5, 6 or more, even more than 8. Have you tried to do like two-dimensional separation, like you can use balance as one dimension and also the level of arousal as another dimension, so you have a more broad spectrum of your data.
That's a very good question. Actually, in the beginning, we were trying to see all the tools we can use to find online, because in San Diego, it's kind of rich, a lot of competition, a lot of tools, but firstly, a tool need to be scalable. Like, get some tools like that they are too slow, difficult to scale. And secondly, some tools they have the tool online, but it's not free. You need to pay money. And about the arousal stuff, we haven't find a very convenient and existing tools like waiting there, and we can use it. But we, our lab, are actually trying to do this related. Because some of the my junior MS, they are trying to build the arousal.
Right. Okay.
We find out the balance of the arousal actually is difficult than we imagine, because so far the tool we know actually is based on the sound, voice,
right.
Not really based on the
text.
And so see from text, actually we would get the value of balance and arousal for every word.
Yeah.
But the combination of them, we do not see any paper working on that, right? Do we see? No. So the students working on that suffered a lot.
Well, you should read more psychology papers, then you probably find some insights.
Yeah. And
get the reference from Professor Chan.
Okay. And actually, in this online version, we removed the 8 emotions because it was too slow. If we include it, it might well take 10 minutes. Give you a result. So now you can see these two people. This is my colleague, and this is Donald Trump. And we predict their age. It's not,
so it's not a very good prediction.
Yes. It's actually they are bad and old people. Because
Why? What's the reason for that?
The training data they use is actually random to use, and most of the users are young people. Actually, they are good at predicting 10-year-old kids. Yeah, not good at all people. So you can see the profile information here, and this is the probability of having, this is by BPD here. And Donald Trump has high probability. And we have bipolar, and Donald Trump has really high probability in here. And
Higher than 15.
Yeah. And this is some social features, some social interaction of numbers. And this is difficult to see. This is actually the frequency of mentioning different tweets with different polarities, negative, positive, and neutral. But now it looks very bad. But on the screen you can see it very clearly. And this is tweet polarity. In here, you cannot see, but Donald Trump has much more positive tweets, and Clinton has more neutral tweets. My colleague is more neutral, and Donald Trump has much more positive tweets. Yeah, I think it's a great topic. And we also present the text cloud of their frequently used word.
So a very tedious question, because I'm not that familiar with all this, work that you're doing. So how does the whatever software or thing that you do deal with abbreviations and typos and things like, if I say, I'm not depressed at all, would that should count as positive, right?
Yeah.
Or neutral? Because when you say, I'm not whatever negative emotion, does that count as a positive?
It depends actually. It depends on the algorithm of the classifier, because it actually sounds quite negative. I'm not
depressed.
But it actually kind of because it doesn't sound like happy. It's kind of happy. It's could be neutral.
Colors.
It really depends on the classifier.
What is the emotion for them?
Yeah.
So you don't know whether the classifier would classify it as
surprise.
As a neutral, as a positive tweet.
I saw this kind of tweet in sarcasm.
Surprise.
at childhood.
Check it. We will check it. What is
the... Yeah, and actually, if we have allowed text, like the population, the sample is much bigger, like we can somehow solve this problem. Like it's possible to classify or wrongly classify one or 10% or two, but if you have large samples, then you can somehow solve this problem.
Yeah, I mean, Asian is usually a hard issues to deal with, and usually you need to do it during pre-processing. And but usually it's a rare case in general. Yeah, right. People just don't express very often.
Yeah,
so how does the system deal with typos or
typos?
Especially if it's emotion related, because that's what you're mainly analyzing.
It actually becomes a big one of the features because well, in middle of line, because we utilize two different emotion classifiers, and actually they consider those typos because usually those typos sometimes contain information, sometimes not. So they have their own way like to consider the typos. And like in our models, in TF-IDF, they just capture all the information, including typos.
Yeah,
because
people...
You did not answer that correctly. No. You need to say something different, like how we try to deal with the typo in our emotion classifier. So you need to talk to me about
that. In the polarity, we have two classifiers. And in the polarity classifier, it's actually an engram-based problem. So you consider typos.
Right.
You cannot consider typos.
It doesn't?
You cannot, because the engram type actually just like if you have a typo, they just cannot recognize.
So, but if the training data contains so many typos, it's possible.
Is the priority is our cases or from other people?
Other.
No, so it doesn't. It doesn't contain the typo. So most of the mechanism, most of the technique people are doing so far, actually, typo is a serious problem. So if they see a typo, they cannot recognize
it. You mean like the word, like if they say E, it's like E.
Unless they have that in their dictionary. Unless they have that in the dictionary. If they don't have that in dictionary, they just do not consider
that.
But
okay.
Our is different. So you need to say why ours is different.
We but actually the tool, they consider typos.
No, unless they have that in dictionary. Ours is different. It's because actually we are not based on the dictionary. We are based on the structure of the word.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also we only rely on some words that are seldom to be mistyped, like and, or, something like that. And usually people do not have a spelling error in such word. And after, by combining of them, actually come out with our emotion classifier, right? So that's supposed to be the answer.
So you somehow like have a typo algorithm that can be taken into account into the spelling of the emotion terms?
Yes.
Right. Okay, that's very smart.
I have to say that.
So how I know that people when they, I mean, not just on Twitter, because when they're posting stuff on social media, they use abbreviations. Like teenagers, they use, so how do you deal with that?
By the way, it is not his work, by the way.
Right,
but the thing that you're so interested is belong to one of our PhD graduates' work.
Right, okay.
This form was there. And the reason is like if they do the abbreviation, usually that should be common.
Uh-huh.
If that is a common,
yeah.
It can be captured into our algorithm.
Right.
It will be in our data set because it's common. But if that's a common, then we will have a second way to know what is the structure of that and so still try to have some guessing. About it. So in the end, it's just having a lot of probability to guessing about which one probably is the best guess for those emotion.
So would it wrongly guess a
yes.
Non-emotion term as the emotion term?
Could be.
Right.
Yeah. So that's why we need like more data.
Yeah. So were there, is there any way to know that if they're like their mother tongue is English, or I mean, for the patient data that you're collecting.
We only consider English speaking users right now, and actually, Twitter. to provide some information to indicate this person is
No, that's a different. That's a different question. A different answer for that question. The monotones, are they native speaker or not?
Yeah.
No. If they are not, well, if they use English, but in
yeah, you don't.
If
you
they are
know.
Actually Chinese or we didn't verify.
We have some problem for that kind of problem. It's like it looks like English,
yeah.
But it's not. It's Indonesia. So right now we have some students working on Indonesia data. It's because it's too much like English, especially Indonesia people also mixing English statement at the same time.
So I assume that for doing studies like that, you don't really need to get consent from the Twitter users because you're using open data.
That's the
maybe
best part.
Maybe 2 years later,
yeah.
It might have that case.
I guess that's my question for now. So,
yeah, I still don't understand how you get the ground truth labels for those mental disorder patients. Because you mentioned that in the beginning you use those kind of self kind of report statements to kind of identify those, but that kind of approach is was very inefficient, right? And so later on, how did you
the data collection part?
Get the ground truth.
So let me share this one.
So experts would be normal, and also random samples would be normal. But yeah, I just don't know how you get it from true occasions.
So each Twitter user have these two distribution.
Yeah, but not many of them. Write them, right? Profile.
The percentage is not very high, but
yeah.
Seems like you had like all the three users, you can still send a lot of users.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is the profile. So the criteria we use to verify is if this person confirms their diagnosis. So this person is a living with BPD,
yeah,
and DD and so on. That's why we judge. So it could be something like I am BPD fighter. Where I live with bipolar for 10 years, something. So that's our judging criteria.
Okay. So just like some keyword kind of detection.
Yeah.
But this is the same as the way you mentioned, the inefficient way, right?
Kind of different.
Kind of different.
Very similar, but kind of different.
Why is it different?
So they use the tweet. First, they use the tweet. And
tweets versus profile.
So tweet is something that if the way we collect Twitter is that we can only correct the current tweet. So,
you can go back, right? Like,
but that with limitations.
Yes.
Serious limitations. So.
Okay. So the thing is, for the data they actually try to working on is that the user have to write that statement. I was diagnosed with X.
Yes.
In that current status, at the time when you crowd or starting to crowd data.
Okay.
And then, but tweets also give you another API. It allow you to crowd the specified user.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem for that is because they don't know which specified user you can crowd.
Okay.
So what we try to know is like we go to the portal
mm-hmm.
and find out who are the follower,
mm-hmm.
crowd them,
mm-hmm.
and then we come back here to check the user profile.
Oh, okay. So the community portal.
Yeah, we try to have the assumption that the people actually follow the community portal having a higher chances to become patient.
Okay. But not all of them, you still do the kind of...
We still need to do the manual checking.
That's
right.
Okay.
So you try to use limited tweets to somehow examine the validity of your model. Have you tried to like to decrease the number of patients that you use to train the model? Say, have you tried to do that to see maybe you just need 50 to get a, like a very significant prediction?
We haven't tried it.
But it can be done.
But it can be done. It's quite easy,
done.
Right?
Yeah,
just randomly
yeah.
sample like 50 or whatever.
Yeah, it's like, like to make an imbalanced data set.
Yeah.
Because
that would be very powerful if you can demonstrate that with like 20 patients that you can get like over 80% precision, then that would be quite amazing.
Yeah,
it would
be
useful. Yeah. But it depends on the number of traits, because it
yes.
I think it affects the way how you calculate the model.
Yes.
Have you tried to look into the relatives of those patients?
Relatives.
Yeah, because I know some relatives might also go to the portal because they want to know how to help
yeah.
with their family.
Yes.
I don't know, would that be the interesting thing to do? Or is it easy to do that? Maybe not. What kind of people would follow a portal like that?
Just like you said, actually, I discovered a lot of relatives, like the wife of the patient, or even the mother, the parents of the patient.
How do you specify, how do you identify them as the relative?
Because in the beginning, when I verified this, those people, I actually manually read to look in detail the profile. So actually, I saw a lot of cases. And in the current state, we just like remove them because their role is kind of awkward because they are. Well, they are kind of close to patients, but I'm really not sure if they are.
It could be a
yeah.
good example that we can still checking on that and maybe doing another different test.
Yeah.
So not just about the expert, and we try to utilize the mother or the relative of
yeah.
them.
Just maybe they are kind of
to mix with it to try to see how different they are.
Yeah, because I think it would be it makes sense that their emotion somehow influenced by it.
So now the model you train, they're doing two different classified analysis. One is to judge whether it's got bipolar, and another is for DBT. Have you tried to like do like a three category classifier so it would automatically judge whether it's a bipolar, a BPD, or none of that? Or maybe both?
Yeah, because right now, it's possible that you have BPD and the same time have having one.
Yeah.
So it's some they are not exclusive. So it's not like different categories. So it's two different things. And secondly, we actually when we include these two disorders, we want to analyze the difference between two. And later we just find out it's very challenging because the data is not clean. Because we read some research. Actually, it says that it's highly possible that doctor. Diagnose the BPD as bipolar or the other way around. And hence they are actually very similar. So right now it's something very difficult to do, like to distinguish both.
Yeah, so it's, I don't know why you chose these two diseases, because if you want to do an easy model to classify people, you may want to choose two different, very different mental disorders, then it'll make your life much, much easier. Because
yeah.
it's very easy to.
At the very beginning, is because we only choosing BPD, we did not choosing bipolar.
Okay.
And the bipolar is side product, it's difficult to partition them. So then we have
yeah.
the bipolar and the BPD together.
Okay. Because it's more difficult because these two do have some similarities. Then if you choose two very different mental disorders, then it'll be easier.
Yes.
Yeah, but the other way around, it'll be more meaningful if you are able to distinguish the two.
Yes.
And I'm actually guessing that the reason why we tried to choose that is because at the very beginning, we did not specify which mental disorder we want working on, but we want to test about our emotion classified and try to see if any disorder would be related to emotion.
Right.
So that time we choosing BPD is because we know that the emotion status changing a lot, so we try to change it. It could be interesting if there's some other mental disorder also affect the emotion. Maybe we can test some about that. Is there any?
Almost all
emotion related.
Yeah.
Most of them are emotion related.
Yeah, I mean, not every, but most of them are emotion related.
I just try to get the sense of the feature, the dimensionality of features. For example, like for Pattern of Life, it would be like 19 features or so. And then for Look, it probably like 60, 70 or 100. Yeah, and then for the idea, probably hundreds, right?
Millions,
right? Yeah, so is that a fair comparison when you do the, say, ROC plots and stuff?
I think it's still fair because sometimes when even if you have lots of dimension, it doesn't mean that it will really improve the...
Yeah, but you need more patterns to kind of fix the model because you have more degree of freedom. And then,
yes.
So it suffers if you don't have a lot of data. Strength
them out. Yeah. Right? So the test that the Professor Huang was on it's a good suggestion, like testing how many patients we need to train for having a good model. Maybe in that cases, if we only having 20 patients to be trained to make the Pattern of Life working better, and but maybe for PFIDF you need hundreds.
Yes.
And then, so from that one, we can see the how the pattern of dye disappear from other part.
Yeah, and actually, this chart shows that when the twist is very limited, TFI performance really bad. But if you have a lot of twists, in the end, it actually performs much better. But it has very high bias, so I don't recommend this much.
And also here, you are using the random forest, right? And,
yes.
So from my experience, say like SVM, and usually if you have unbalanced like number of samples for each category, it picks up the prior, and then if the model faces an ambiguous case, then usually it just like go
to the major.
Yeah, to the major one. Yeah. So, but I'm not sure about the property of the random forest. But probably you can consider to use a more kind of balanced number of samples for each category here, because example you have only like 20 something users for those patients per category, and then for random samples or normal people you have like 500 for each patient.
Now, actually, the component they are issuing in the research is not that serious, because you can see that. So if you want to build a bipolar classifier, you have 278. Well, the ratio is still quite close.
Okay.
Yeah. So in better data, maybe it's like 10 to 1. So this case is actually quite relaxed in that problem.